David, we know those renewable energy target dates of 2030, 2050. When we think about Canada's energy transition, what should the focus be on in 2023?
I think the focus needs to be on thinking about what the end goal is, really getting a clear picture on what does a net zero 2050 look like? And what does it mean for Canada? And what can we do that actually allows Canada to win in this transition within all of our other competitors around the world that are also trying to look for new market opportunities? And I think a real focus has to be on our energy carriers. What we're using most of our emissions in Canada come from the production and combustion of four or five energy carriers: gasoline, diesel, jet fuel, and natural gas. We need to find alternatives to those energy carriers that we can make in Canada and use to drive our economies and export energy to other nations. And that's where our focus needs to be.
Let's talk about some of those opportunities for Canada. What does that look like?
Well, I think we're going to see some prototypes or some pilots in the next 12 months around the hydrogen opportunity. Hydrogen is a energy carrier that when you combust it, it produces no greenhouse gas emissions. And so like electricity, hydrogen and electricity are both zero emission energy carriers. And the trick is we have to figure out how to make them without greenhouse gas emissions in the production of them. But also we need to change the energy service technologies, how we move around, how we heat our homes and provide hot water, how we make things in industry that are going to use these new zero emission energy carriers instead of some of the traditional carbon-based energy carriers. And we are going to see in the next 12 months some pilot and demonstration projects coming online for the first time. Many of these projects have been in the works for 3 or 4 years. We're going to be seeing in the next few weeks some hydrogen fuel cell buses being deployed within the Edmonton region, the city of Edmonton, city of Strathcona. They'll be on the road carrying passengers. If they can work well within the winter conditions in Alberta, they can work well just about anywhere in Canada. So that's going to be interesting. We're seeing heavy duty trucks running on hydrogen coming on the road in the next 3 or 4 months, and also hydrogen trains with CP Rail, and also hydrogen being put into natural gas systems as a blending to start to decarbonize our space heating. So I think all of these are going to be initiatives that are going to be in actual deployment within the next 12 months. And this has been years of work by many different groups across Canada have been working to actually get these things deployed and demonstrate that we do have a net zero alternatives that are credible and compelling.
David, let's talk about some of the challenges. In the past, you and I have talked about the infrastructure, the distribution, the funding. Can we expect more of the same hurdles for the new year?
Well, I think a number of funding announcements have been made by federal government and provincial governments over the past year or so. I think there's a fair amount of money on the table right now. I would like to see all better coordination of that funding to make sure that it's going to be spent properly and with a clear view as to where we're trying to go and what needs to be done and what questions and challenges we need to address. One of the things that I think is a real challenge is we still tend to think in energy system silos, if you like. We really have three energy systems operating in Canada and around the world today. We have an electrical grid, electrical system. We have a transportation system that basically relies on oil and products coming from oil. And then we have a heating requirement, space and industrial heating. We have now, as we look to transform our energy systems to zero emissions and to make them more sustainable, is maybe break down some of the barriers between those three energy systems. And and the vision that we have within the Transition Accelerator is that is the key thing to look at is the ability of electricity and hydrogen to actually be supportive of each other and to support not only our electrical system, not our heating system, but also our transportation system. And that requires a new way of thinking that I think is going to be absolutely critical over the next year and the next few years to rethink the ability to redesign our energy systems and create a more integrated, more robust energy system overall that will actually serve our electricity needs, our heating needs, our transportation needs. And I think that's getting a clearer view on that and making sure that government dollars are helping us move towards that goal of a more integrated and robust energy system, and perhaps that can make some significant improvements on the systems that we have today.
How much should we be paying attention to what our neighbors to the south are doing?
I think we have to pay a lot of attention. They're our major trading partners, a lot of innovation there, but they're also our customers as well. And I think that a lot of the energy that we produced in Canada today, we export to the United States. I can envisage us continuing to export energy, but my hope is that we will start to change the energy carriers that we export, rather than perhaps, right now we send them a lot of oil, we send the Americans a lot of natural gas and some electricity. I would like to see us really start working very closely with some multi-billion-dollar investments that are going on in the United States to grow a hydrogen economy there, that we figure out how we can help provide and fuel that hydrogen economy, but also learn and from the technologies and bring some of the technologies they're developing there to Canada and get them deployed here, create the jobs and the opportunity here. So I think we need to develop an integrated energy system with the United States. They are moving very quickly with the Inflation Reduction Act, very quickly towards some major initiatives that will move towards zero emission energy carriers. And I think we need to adjust our policies a bit to make sure that we keep up, but actually in take advantage of some of the opportunities that are created by a United States that is trying to move quickly in this direction as well.
2022 saw an energy crisis with Russia's war on Ukraine, and given that domino effect around the world, energy security seems to be dominating that narrative now. How do you look at energy security as we go into the new year?
Well, I think there's been a number of studies, again, on looking at how Canada could perhaps start to, we have pretty good energy security in Canada already. We are a major energy producer and exporter. But I think Canada's role in the energy security is in many ways to actually provide energy, high quality energy, reasonable priced energy to the rest of the world to help them cope with Russia basically invading Ukraine and disrupting global markets. There has certainly been a lot of focus on LNG exports. I would love to see a lot more focus on the possibility of exporting ammonia as an energy carrier. Certainly Germany and Japan and South Korea and a few other countries of the world have expressed a very strong interest in importing ammonia, because it's an energy, it's really, we think of it as it's a fertilizer right now, but it's also a very energy rich molecule. And there's many countries of the world that see ammonia as an energy, zero emission energy carrier of the future. Because when you combust ammonia and get the energy out of it, you don't get greenhouse gases. So that creates another zero emission energy carrier that Canada is one of the lowest cost producers in the world. And we could take advantage of that fact and find access to global markets. It's going to require interprovincial cooperation for moving ammonia to the tidewaters, but also there's opportunities, as we've seen in Newfoundland, in the Stephenville area, where the German chancellor, the prime minister, talked about earlier this year about a large solar project, a wind project, actually, that would be producing hydrogen and then ammonia for export to Germany. And I think seeing that, those kind of projects develop, I think would be very interesting. And I think there are many other initiatives and technologies that Canada could actually really develop and deploy here and then export those to other nations.